In the British Museum in London, there's an ancient clay tablet on exhibit. The artifact dates back to Mesopotamia, specifically to a city-state known as Ur. Etched onto its face, the tablet has a message, and it expresses its sculptor's profound displeasure. At the start of the 1900s, a British man called Sir Leonard Woolley first investigated the site of Ur. As a result of his meticulous means of research, Woolley is thought of as a pivotal figure within contemporary archaeology. He made multiple discoveries at Ur and helped to construct a clearer image of what the city once looked like. Ur was an important place within the Sumer civilization, which itself was among the first ever mass societies in history. Sumer sat in the south of Mesopotamia, in the southern part of what we today call Iraq. Experts believe that settlements first sprung up in Sumer between 5500 BC and 4000 BC. It's thought that Sumerian society really started to take shape between 4000 BC and 3100 BC. This time is known as the Uruk period, and it saw the land becoming more urbanized. Towards the end of this era, Sumer had split into multiple city-states. Canals were constructed and boundaries were then raised to distinguish between these city-states. Each one had a patron deity, whom the population would worship in temples built in their honor. Kings or governors known as Lugals or Ensis ran the city. Although some believe the earliest cities emerged in India or China, it's broadly thought that these Sumerian cities were the first. Eridu is believed to be the oldest of these, and it can still be seen today as ruins. About 7.5 miles away from Eridu lies evidence of the city of Ur. Ur flourished in the area defined as modern Iraq's Dikar province. At one time, Ur stood by the waters of the Persian Gulf, but the coastline has since altered. Today, you can find the remains of the city quite a bit away from the coast. Back then, Ur divided into different districts, with people of specific professions living in the same areas. Streets ran through the city with clearings to allow for public assemblies. There's even evidence that Ur contained designs to aid in flood management. Residents built homes in Ur with plaster and bricks made from mud. Larger structures were shored up with asphalt. And it seems that the dead found their final resting place underneath houses, buried with objects such as weapons and cooking utensils. A series of fortifications standing about 26 feet high defended Ur. These lay at a slant, and some of the city's buildings adjoined them. And in addition to these man-made defenses, the Euphrates River to the west added further security. Evidence of the city has survived through the millennia. The Ziggurat of Ur is among the most impressive ruins of Ur that can be seen today. Ziggurats were large structures constructed throughout Mesopotamia for religious purposes. Construction of the Ziggurat of Ur was started by King Ur-Nammu for the sake of honoring Nana, the moon god, also known as Sin. Nana was the patron god of Ur. He was believed specifically to look after shepherds. By the time the ziggurat had been completed, King Ur-Nammu's son, Shulgi, ruled Ur. King Shulgi designated himself as a god, and under his tenure, Ur grew immensely more powerful. By the end of his 48 years in control, Ur oversaw a large portion of Mesopotamia. Several archaeological discoveries have suggested the prosperity enjoyed by the city of Ur. Various precious metals have been uncovered there, metals that would have only made it to the city through trade networks. In fact, trade in general was one of the major contributing factors to Ur's affluence. Having a port along the Persian Gulf helped to ensure that Ur was a significant place of trade. Indeed, the city received goods from many places around the world. A large part of the trade in the whole of Mesopotamia, in fact, flowed through the port at Ur. It's been suggested that Ur had a hierarchical society. At the bottom, people from other parts of the world were sometimes seized and put into slavery. Toward the top, figures such as priests enjoyed lives of considerable opulence. There's even evidence of intricate legal and economic organization in Ur. The discovery of several artifacts bearing texts supports this notion. Sumerians inscribed these texts in cuneiform, one of the oldest known writing schemes. The word cuneiform derives from the Latin word cuneiformis. This translates roughly as wedge-shaped. This is in relation to the wedge-shaped etchings that scribes stamped onto the clay slabs that still bear cuneiform. Anywhere from 500,000 to 2 million cuneiform tablets have been discovered over the centuries. Of these, however, only between 30,000 and 100,000 have ever been publicly presented. A great many museums contain extensive collections of these tablets, with the British Museum holding the most. Indeed, it's the British Museum that holds the tablet expressing the annoyance of one particular ancient person named Nani. Nani carved out his disapproval to a merchant called Ia Nasir, who had provided him with the incorrect sort of copper, and the resulting tablet is now recognized as one of the first ever recorded customer complaints. Adolf Leo Oppenheim is responsible for translating the text etched into the tablet. Oppenheim was a celebrated Assyriologist who entered the world in Vienna, Australia. It has been claimed that he studied cuneiform more than any modern-day individual. In fact, Oppenheim's expertise is largely credited to much of our present understanding of what life was like in Mesopotamia. He served as the leading editor of the Chicago Assyrian Dictionary, which sought to take stock of the Akkadian language. He remained in this role until his death in 1974. "What do you take me for that you treat somebody like me with such contempt?" a disgruntled Nani wrote to Ia Nasir, as translated by Oppenheim. "I have sent messengers to collect the bag with my money, deposited with you, but you have treated me with contempt by sending them back to me empty-handed several times." Nani's complaint had been inscribed in Akkadian, a long-lost language articulated in Mesopotamia roughly between 2800 BC and 500 AD. In cuneiform, Akkadian was made up of about 600 word and syllable symbols. It's thought that several of these symbols were pronounced in several different ways. "How have you treated me for that copper?" Nani continued. "You have withheld my money bag from me in enemy territory." On top of that, Nani provided a solution. "It's now up to you to restore my money to me in full." Concluding, Nani wrote, "Take cognizance that from now on I will not accept any copper from you that is not of fine quality. I shall, from now on, select and take the ingots individually in my own yard, and I shall exercise against you my right of rejection because you have treated me with contempt." Nani's complaint first found itself in the media back in 2016. However, it was again posted to Reddit in 2018 and has since gone viral. More than 1,000 comments have been written in response to the post, with more than 64,000 upvotes. Nani's message, however, is far from the only complaint aimed at Ia Nasir. Indeed, it was merely the longest and most detailed of several. At least 12 other cuneiform complaints bound for the merchant have also been uncovered. The tablets were uncovered in what is thought to be Ia Nasir's home. Each one was aimed at Ia Nasir himself, and they were all written in particularly bitter tones. Indeed, the tablets are linked together in the specific irritation that they express. Taken together, the complaints paint a picture of who Ia Nasir actually was. It seems that he was a prominent merchant within Ur who specialized in the large-scale trade of metal blocks. He also worked in the business of formed metal commodities, food, and fabrics. Ia Nasir was part of an association of traders known as Alik Tilmun. This group centered in Dilmun, an area that stood in what is now Bahrain. Dilmun was well located at the time for business, so many traders flocked there. When he was starting out as a merchant, Ia Nasir was involved in trading practices on behalf of Ur's royal residents. He was initially thought reliable, but after some time it seems he began to spend more time in Dilmun, and so some of his clients began to get annoyed. As well as Nani's complaint, a cuneiform note from a person called Arbitaram has also been found, which was intended for Ia Nasir. Like Nani, it seems Arbitaram had been swindled out of his copper by the merchant. Arbitaram wrote, "Why have you not given me the copper? If you do not get it, I will recall your pledges." After not receiving a reply, Arbitaram is naturally upset and is compelled to follow up with Ia Nasir. "Why have you not given the copper to my colleague?" he carved into a tablet. "Be kind enough to give me the copper." Another person, Imjur Sin, had evidently reached exhaustion because of Ia Nasir's shoddy business practice. "In order that your heart shall not be troubled, give good copper to my colleague," Imjur Sin wrote. "Do you not know how tired I am of this?" A man by the name of Lisu Elatsu is believed to be one of Ia Nasir's professional associates, and it seems that he too had grown weary of Ia Nasir's poor business practices. Consequently, one tablet inscribed by Lisu Elatsu warns Ia Nasir to behave. "Act in such a way that the customer will not become angry," he wrote. It's not known if Ia Nasir sent a response to any of these grievances. Indeed, based on the evidence of his bad business sense, it would come as no surprise to learn that he had not. However, experts believe that his awful manner of working eventually got the better of him. There are signs that Ia Nasir's prosperity eventually began to deteriorate. For example, his home, where the tablets had been discovered, was connected to the neighboring residence. This considerably lessened the available space of his house. Furthermore, it appears that Ian Asir was compelled to change the nature of his business dealings. In fact, he moved into areas such as real estate and clothing. These markets would have been notably less fruitful than copper trading. So, Ian Asir, it would appear, treated his clients with contempt, and he paid the price for it. And he was driven out of the well-paying copper market because of his poor entrepreneurship. And he's even remembered for it almost four millennia later.